anyone brought anything to eat? Jesus said in the verse 34, my food, meat is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say that there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for the harvest. And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored, and now you have entered into their labors.
Thank you, Lord.
The text, verse 39. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified, he told me all I ever did. So when the Samaritans had come to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 more days. And many more believed because now of his own word. And then they said to the woman, now we believe, not just because of what you said, but for we ourselves have heard him, and we know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Now, after those 2 days, he departed and went there to Galilee. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated in his presence this morning. Praise God. The text verse is verse 39. When you take your seat, I want you to mark it in your Bible. It's not going to be a long time, but heard this message, and next Sunday I'll be preaching the same thing.
John chapter 4.
And God, there's 66 books and so many verses to choose from for the same message. Amen. Let's read out loud together John chapter number 4, verse 39. Are you ready?
Yes.
1, 2, 3, read. And many of the Samaritans believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified, he told me all that I ever did. Amen? Would you mark that in your Bible? Amen? So this entire region many times has been attributed to the Italian leader of the centurions called Cornelius. But I want to break that because that's not really true. The first Gentile preacher was the Samaritan woman.
Amen.
See, I y'all didn't know that.
Amen.
We say, oh, well, the first person that got the Gentile saved was Cornelius. And no, that's not true, because by the time the gospel got to Cornelius, all of Samaria had been saved. And Samaria was a Gentile city. So this first message of the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Samaritans came simply as the woman's testimony. Just simply the woman's testimony. Come see a man who has told me everything that I've ever done. So as we continue our message in terms of evangelism and stirring up the joy of our salvation once again, I want to ask you a question this morning, and this will be the subject that I will use for this day. Are you ready?
Amen.
Where would you be today if you had never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ?
Wow.
Where would you be today? And I want you to really think about this. Where would you really be today if you had never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ? Now, look at where the Lord has brought you from and think about for just a moment what you were saved from.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't look at whether or not you got it all right or whether it's nailed down and perfect today, but look for a moment, somewhere in the recesses of your own mind, and think through this question. Where would I be Jesus Christ, where would I be today? Would I still even be living?
No.
Would I be dead? Would I have been murdered? Would I have been killed? Would I have committed suicide? What path was I on? Where would I have ended if today I had not heard the gospel of Jesus Christ? And think about when you first started hearing the gospel. Think about the environment, whether it was church, whether it was Sunday school, whether it was at your home with your parents or with your caregivers. Maybe it was at school, or maybe it was at camp. But try to think through all the clutter of our lives and get back to when you first started hearing about Jesus Christ. When did you first hear that name, Jesus Christ? Where did it come? Was it an old mother somewhere on a bus? Was it someone at school? Was it a Sunday school teacher? Well, was it at BTU or BYPU, wherever you were? Was it at annual conference, annual district conference, whether it was convocation? Where were you when you first heard the name Jesus Christ? How old were you? Were you a child? Were you an adolescent? Were you a teenager? Or were you an adult? Maybe it was at the plant. Maybe it was on your job. Maybe you had escaped through childhood and your teenage years, and for some reason that message didn't get to you. But at some point, because you're here today, you are evidence that there was a point, a moment in time where the name Jesus Christ entered into your reality.
Amen.
Now think about where you would be today if you had never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. If no one had ever witnessed to you the gospel of Jesus Christ, where would you be? And as I was praying and meditating over our phenomenal Tuesday service we had this past Tuesday, our Bible study, where so many people got up to give their testimony of when the gospel pricked their heart and they were converted.
That's right.
Amen. I think about this text in terms of how critical a witness can be. How vital one testimony can be. Because all of us are here today because somebody, maybe it was Billy Graham, I grew up in a Christian home. And so it was not uncommon at the breakfast table to hear my parents pray over the meal and end in the name of Jesus. It was not uncommon for us to pray by my bed as a girl, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take it. Mama would add, now pray for everybody. And I would pray for my mama, Lord. I pray for my daddy, and I pray for my auntie, and I pray for this person and that person. She would say, now end it in the name of Jesus. And then when Billy Graham would come on with all of his great crusades, and I would sit on the floor next to my father watching that black and white TV.
Yes.
And I would hear him sing that song, he and George Beverly Shea, "Just As I Am Without One Plea. That thy blood was shed for me. And biddest me to come, O Lamb of God, I come, I come."
Mm-hmm.
As I would hear that, that was reinforcing the message. I wasn't old enough at that point to recognize that I needed to be saved, but the witness was all around me.
Amen.
And I knew that there was something different about my house than the house next door or the house down the street.
Yeah. Yeah.
And what I discovered is that the house next door didn't have Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
And our house had Jesus. And we would talk about Jesus. We would get up and go to church. And it was normal for us. And when we would come back home from church, the house next door to us, they was just getting up. Coming down and sit on the high, on the porch in their house clothes. Y'all don't know nothing about house clothes. Because now they wear house clothes outside. We had outside clothes. And we had house clothes. We didn't wear our pajamas to the grocery store. Where would you be today if there had not been a witness that entered into your reality and shared with you the gospel of Jesus Christ? The text is very, I think, loud in our ear this morning when it says that many of the Samaritans, verse 9, of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified. He told me all that I'd ever done. I think about this as I went back and thought about the condition of the Samaritans, how they lived very adjacent to those who were Jews, and that there had been this great gulf between them, the Jews and the Gentiles, over some land way in the Old Testament. So, because they were Samaritans, the Jews had no dealings with them.
Right.
And so, the gospel message by this Jewish rabbi would have never gotten to them.
Right.
Because those who were still injured, those who were still offended by the Samaritans, would have never taken the good news of Jesus Christ into Samaria. But if you go back to the text in John chapter 4, verse 1, Jesus says, I need to go to Samaria.
Yeah.
Right.
It's a very profound scripture.
Yeah.
And I said to the text, why did he need to go? And the text said, because the good news would have never gotten there because of the offense between the Jews and the Gentiles. Jews and Samaritans had been beefing over land for years.
Yes.
And so all of the miracles would have stayed in a nearby town. All of the things that he was speaking, all the good news, all his teaching, would have never crossed the gulf of their offense. Even though the towns were adjacent to one another.
Yeah.
Even though they could have literally walked to each other's territory. But because of the offense, Samaria lied in sin. They were going to remain in a place of apathy, and without Christ, they would have died and gone to hell. Sometimes we don't witness to the people we don't like. We don't witness to the people that we have an offense with. And we can sometimes live in the same house, be in the same family, have the same aunts and uncles. But because there is an offense, or because there is a gulf between us, the good news doesn't get them. So God has to use somebody else.
Right.
Yes,
right.
God has to use somebody else, to be a witness to you.
That's right.
So here these towns are close together. They butt up against each other. A pocket of the area, the region where the Jews lived. And then the next little pocket was where the Samaritans lived. They always lived adjacent to each other. They always shared the same border.
Yeah.
But because of the gulf, they never talked to each other. They fought over land. They fought over the well. They fought over the territory. But Jesus said, I need to go to Samaria. When he got there, he finds this woman who is going out in the middle of the day to gather water. You all know the story. And Jesus begins to share with her this mighty
history of worship and water. He's really talking about the Holy Spirit. John chapter 7 says that the water was really the Holy Spirit. Right. He said that if you believe upon me, as the scriptures have said, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Mm-hmm. But when he was talking to the woman at the well in John 4, he simply said, if you knew who you were talking to, come on,
yeah,
you would ask me for water.
Right.
And the water that I give you, if you drink it, you'll never thirst again.
Yes.
This water was the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
The woman said, give me the water.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he said, but wait, done not so fast. Before I give it to you, I need you to go call your husband.
Yeah.
And he said, she said, what do you mean, husband? I don't have a husband. And he said, you're right, because you've had five and none of them were yours. And the one you got now is not yours.
Mm.
And she said, I perceive that you are a prophet. I guess you do.
Well,
but as they commune, John does not write the rest of the conversation. He doesn't write the rest of the dialogue between them. We just jump to a point in the text where it says she dropped her water pots.
Right.
Her agenda changed. No longer was looking for water at a well. Now was filled with living water. And the Bible says that she runs into town,
yes,
and she finds the men.
Uh-huh.
Important part of the text.
Yes. Yes.
Very vital. That the very people sometimes you mess up with,
yes,
are the very people that God wants you to witness to.
Yes. Yes.
Somebody caught that. She runs in town and she tells the men, says, y'all, I thought y'all was it. We used to have a lady here named Aunt Josie. And Aunt Josie was related to Mother Cohen, her auntie. And Aunt Josie would come and say, I want to hear that one. I don't want to hear this one no more. I want to hear from you. And we would make light of it and make fun of it. But I can see that working in this text. They never thought that this woman would be the reason that they came to know Jesus Christ. They never considered that she was bringing some type of good news. They never considered that this woman that they knew most intimately, her reputation, had somehow become a witness for some man sitting back in the city on a well somewhere.
Yeah.
Our salvation has become
become so common to us, we don't see the value of it anymore. It's just our normal life. I'm sanctified, filled with the precious Holy Ghost, and that's what a mighty burning fire. And I'm on my way to heaven to see what the end will be. Those of you that know the work of prayer, pray my strength in the Lord. And so our salvation now is not to us as precious as it was when we first believed. Because when we first believed, we can remember the tears that were coming out of our eyes and the mention of the name of the Lord Jesus. We can remember how tender we were to the prodding of the Holy Spirit. We can remember how the words of the gospel message would flow out of our hearts so easily, and how quick we were to share how we were before and now how we are and how we got there. Well, nothing from us. You know, just say Jesus. Old people say the washing machine with the weed. We didn't have no automatic. We had a ringer washing machine. And the ringer would be Jesus.
Yeah.
Rocking the rocking chair, everything said Jesus.
Yeah.
If you wanted it everywhere, you put it on your bedroom wall, you put it everywhere you can put it. You wrote it in your little book at school, Jesus. Because you were still tender and your salvation was still fresh and it was still valuable to you. But after years of walking through life, after years of tragedies and trouble and pain and suffering and sickness, somewhere under the rubble of our own life, our salvation is still glistening.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
But it's covered over with clutter and offenses and problems and bills and family and choices and mistakes.
Yeah.
But somewhere under the rubble,
yeah,
our salvation is still glistening,
yeah,
more precious than gold.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
But it's so common to us now. We have insulated ourselves and almost isolated ourselves from everybody that's not saved. So salvation is common among our friends.
Yeah.
It's common among the people we talk to. It's,
yeah,
common now among our family. It's common among our church. So it's nothing new. So it's easy for us to go a whole day and not necessarily talk about Jesus. Because it's already a known in the room.
Yeah.
It's already familiar to everybody that's present.
Right.
Unless we just absolutely are deliberate and intentional about it, we just don't even talk about how salvation is. One witness. Salvation was still fresh within hours that she had drank from the water. She received this Messiah, this rabbi that sat on the well. She received him now as a savior. Now he has given her the Holy Spirit. And the first thing she does, which proves that she had the Holy Spirit, is that she wanted to be a witness.
Yeah.
Oh, tongues don't prove you have the Holy Ghost. Witness, it proves that you have the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Oh, but I'm over here in this little
corner.
Because I need y'all to hear what I just said. See, the first thing that we receive is the evidence.
Right.
But that don't prove that you got the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Come on,
somebody. Yeah.
That just proves
that you got the Holy Ghost. Come on, yeah. Right.
You still figure it out, but you still don't have no witness.
Come on.
You still have winning souls, so I know the Holy Ghost don't have you. Because Jesus says in Acts chapter number 1, verse 8, before he leaves it, Luke records it, that ye shall receive power. After the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses.
Right.
In Jerusalem, look at here, in Judea, where else? And Samaria.
Yes.
And to the uttermost parts of the world. So I know that there is a disconnect between us and our first experience with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Our witness is waning. Not only has it waned, we don't even remember the last time we got somebody saved.
came to the altar and I asked you to come up and help me. No. In your life. We almost can't remember. Last time we actually one-on-one was a witness to someone, but yet we sit here today. The only reason that we're here today is because somebody witnessed you to us.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
When you stop and think for a minute, that old question of where would I be today if somebody had not witnessed, had not told me about Jesus Christ, where would I be today? When you think of the awful reality of that, you can see how vital a witness is. You're not going to come to Jesus by instinct.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Amen.
They just gonna wake up one day and say, "Ooh, I just really think I should go and be saved." Somebody got a witness. Somebody got to mention the name of Jesus. Somebody got to say something about the Lord. Somewhere you had to hear the gospel. Somewhere you had to hear about Jonah. Somewhere you had to hear about the three Hebrew boys. Somewhere you had to hear about Daniel and the lion's den. I don't know where it was that you heard, but you heard it somewhere. And at the time in which was appointed for you to be converted, you heard the gospel, Ephesians 1:19, and you believed. But long before you heard it, the day you believed, somewhere they had been witnessing. Somebody, your grandmama, an auntie, somebody had been telling you about Jesus. And the day in which was appointed for you to be converted, your heart was ready. Somebody witnessed. Somebody told you about Jesus Christ. It might have been in a camp. It might have been in jail. The woman said on this past Tuesday that she was in jail 12 calendar years. I can't imagine being behind bars 1 hour.
Right.
Less long, she said 12 calendar years. She said, and everybody around me that was in the prison, there was some older women in there that was talking about Jesus Christ. She started hearing about Jesus, and they invited her to the chapel. She started going to the chapel, and she went to the chapel and said, I need something so I can learn. Can I get a Bible? And she said, I'm going to give you a Bible, but I got some tapes here by Evangelist Coletta Harris.
Yeah.
And she took those cassettes, not CDs. She took those cassettes to a jail cell. Where she listened to them for 12 calendar years. She would go out on the yard and would be listening to Evangelist Claude Harris spread the word, go tell ministries. And she heard purge out the living. She heard abortion unto righteousness. She heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. And she said, would you be today? But underneath the rubble of life, church on friend and family day. We can't get two people. She went into the town and the whole city came to see this man. She didn't lay hands on him. She didn't lead him through the sinner's prayer. She just said, come see me. Come meet this guy. Because what he just did for me, he might be able to do it for you. Just come to church with me. Just let me tell you about a man that told me everything about myself. Many of the Samaritans got out there and they heard him. And then they said to the woman, now you got us here. But now we believe because of what we heard him say. So the text says to me that it's not my job to get them saved, but my witness is to get them to Jesus.
Yes.
And once they get to Jesus, God will say that to them.
Yeah.
Once they get in the environment, once they get in the right room, the right church, they'll hear the gospel and their hearts will be made to believe.
Only one, yes.